Welcome to this video series on directed acyclic graphs. This is a continuation of the video series on causality. And in this video series, we'll teach you a bit of the basics about how to estimate directed acyclic graph from data. We also have another video series on this topic as well that is optional. And in this video series, we go into a bit more of the technical details. Here, the focus is really to get some quick ideas about what kind of algorithms you can use and how to use them also in R. I'll start with a quick recap. This is a directed acyclic graph, and the term acyclic is important because that means that you assume that you cannot have any arrow going backwards. So A cannot eventually cause itself. And we can understand this bigger directed acyclic graph as consisting of many smaller elements. Elements of three nodes, like for example this part here, or this part here. Really any series of three nodes you can see as a smaller system like that, which we can understand quite well. So the main structures that we can find in these three node DAGs are the common cause, the chain graph, and the collider structure. And the common cause says that one variable, in this case B, causes two other variables, in this case A and C. So for example, we could have a disease, an underlying disease, let's say COVID-19, that causes symptoms like coughing and throat pain. Right? Then after we control, so these symptoms will correlate. They will be dependent. That means that if you see one with throat pain, that person might also be coughing more likely than you would expect an average person to be coughing. But after controlling on the underlying disease, so if you look at only people that have COVID-19, then these symptoms should be independent. So given that we control for the cause of the correlation in this case as well, then these symptoms become independent. So that means that we have this independent structure here, which says that A and C are conditionally independent, but marginally, or without conditioning on anything, dependent. And we also have the chain graph here that says that A causes B and B causes C. So for example, insomnia might cause fatigue, and fatigue might in turn cause concentration problems. In that case, we actually have the exact same conditional independence relationship that we have with the common cause. You can see that here. So we can see that A and C are likely correlated. They're not independent. But after we control for this middle node in the network or in the DAG, these two become correlated. So they become independent. So they're no longer correlated. So these are actually very much the same in terms of conditional independence relationships. And that's quite important because that means that you cannot really distinguish between them. You can, however, test this hypothesis. So if you have the hypothesis that this is your model, we can test that and then see if the conditional independence holds up or not. The last model is the collider structure. And this says that A and C cause a third variable, in this case B. So for example, the difficulty of the class and the intelligence or the motivation of a student can cause the grade. And this has an entirely different independent structure. Namely that in this case, A and C are independent. Maybe we don't see any effect here. And what you sometimes see is that these will be denoted as being correlated or like a latent variable there. But for now, we don't do that. So let's check this out. So A and C are independent, so they're not correlated, but after conditioning on the common effect, they become dependent. Right? So A and C now become dependent. And this is also something that's discussed in many of the other videos, especially in the undirected network models videos. This is discussed in much more detail. Now, when you have a directed acyclic graph, we can find the conditional independence relationships simply by looking at the graph, which is quite cool. So for example, in this graph, we can look at it and we can see that B and F are conditionally independent given C. And this we can do through the rules of deseparation. We explain the concept of deseparation in other videos in much more detail, so I don't go into much detail here. But in essence, it's a way to check from the graph if two variables are conditionally independent given a third variable. And you can do that, for example, by seeing, okay, we have B, we have F. What are all the paths between B and F? In this case, it would be B, C, F, that's one. But we also have B, C, D, E, F, that's two. And I don't think there's any other one. And then on each of those two paths, is C a middle node in the chain or a common cause? Yes, then C blocks B and F. And then that means that B and F are conditionally independent given C. And that's the main idea here. If C is the middle effect of a common effect or the effect of a common effect structure, the middle node, then it would not block. It would in fact unblock the path between B and F. So it means that it would be dependent, but that's not the case here. So this means that with a directed acyclic graph, we can list a lot of hypotheses that are can be derived from this DAG structure. So this DAG structure leads to a lot of hypotheses. Right? It leads to the hypothesis A is independent of B. It leads to the hypothesis A is independent of D given C. It leads to the hypothesis B is independent of G given C and E, etc., 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 etc. So that means that we can try to evaluate our causal theory, which is a very powerful thing. So this could be our causal model. And then we can see, okay, I have a lot of hypotheses and we're going to try to reject these hypotheses. And if we can't, then that is in a way evidence for the model, right? So because we tried to reject the model in many ways and we couldn't. So that's something we could do. We could run all these tests, right? These are partial correlation tests, for example. Or conditional independence test, depending on what type of data you have. We can run all these tests and then see if the model holds up. Now, an extremely powerful thing is that if you have continuous variables, then we can do something called structural equation modeling to test all these hypotheses in one go. And that is because if you have continuous variables, we can assume a normal distribution. And that normal distribution only requires a variance covariance matrix, which we often call like sigma, for example. In structural equation modeling, and if you don't know about it, this is a very powerful modeling framework in which you can model simultaneous equations, but also latent variables and causal models like this. And recently, even networks as well. In structural equation modeling, basically what you do is you try to form a model for this sigma. Now, if multivariate normality holds, then the Schur complement, which is something you can look up on Wikipedia if you want, it's just a mathematical expression, tells us that any conditional covariance can be expressed in terms of marginal covariances. So marginal covariance is a covariance that is not conditional, so not partial. So this tells me that the covariance between two variables is a function of this covariance between two variables. Another covariance between two variables, the inverse of a variance, so that's just 1 over some variance, and another covariance. And these are all elements from sigma. So that means that in structural equation modeling, where we model this sigma, at the same time, we're modeling all implied variance, conditional covariance as well. So that means that we are modeling all these tests at once. And in structural equation modeling, you get like a few fit measures to tell you if the model is good or not. And those will also tell you at the same time how plausible it is that all these assumptions or all these tests hold up. So that's extremely powerful. And that's a way in which you can fit a directed acyclic graph. If you have non-normal data, there are other things you can do. It gets a bit more complicated. But for continuous data, this is a very powerful technique. Now, we don't teach more about structural equation modeling in this course, but if you're interested, I have an entire video course on this on my website as well, so you can go there, just sascheepkamp.com. Now, an important last consideration is that you have equivalent models in DAG, so that means that if this model fits, so do these. All right, so if you have a model and you get a fit, you do SEM, for example, you get a good fit index, then you should realize that also these models fit as well, so they're equivalent. And that is a problem. That is also a problem in estimating DAG models without knowing the structure. Right? So in SAM, you need to know the structure, but we might not know that yet. And that's what the rest of this video series is about. We want to estimate this structure from data. And then this might be a problem, because if we just simply have three variables, A, B, and C, and all we can find in the data is that A is independent of C given B, then all of these DAGs can be true. So then we wouldn't know exactly which of these would be correct. Now, what we're going to do in the DAG estimation is to help the DAG estimation a lot. First by adding a few more variables from three. You like to be around six, seven variables maybe, or five. And second, mainly, is that you can remove some edges. So for example, A might be like childhood trauma, for example, and this might be symptoms now. So then you know that this one cannot happen. So you can remove those, right? And if you know that, then there's only one that left. So that's gonna be a trick that we're gonna use in the next videos.